What's good, y'all? It's your boy Isiah Anderson Jr. here again with Barbershop Series Build in the Building. Got my man Dre, my man DQ in the building. And we here, y'all. We just gonna, you know, let y'all know what's going on with us. Talk about some why we do this barbershop series. Why is it important to us? You know, and how does it affect what we do and how we move forward? So we just gonna let y'all kick off. I'm gonna let Dre say a little something real quick.
Hey, what's up, y'all? This is Dre with Brothers United Leadership Development Build. We talked about this at the barbershop series. We've been doing this for some years, really opportunity for us to go out into the community where they're at. We switched it up this year and did it virtual. We're still in a pandemic. We're ready for this stuff to be over so we can get out in community with y'all. But we're up in the building, in the Build 206 studio, trying to make things happen. And we're going to continue having these conversations, share a little bit of why we do what we do and how we do it and what we've been doing and what we're looking forward to doing with this barbershop series and other things that we got going on as well.
Yeah. And we also got in front of the camera. We got DG in the building, Darryl Glover. Man, go on, talk to us a little bit, man. Tell us who you are, what you do. Everybody know you, but go ahead and reintroduce yourself.
Man, introducing me on this side of the camera. This is a weird feeling, man. But, DQ, Darryl Glover is my name. I have a media company, Dancing in the Rain Media. Been around for about 5 years doing that, in community, present. Very present and just looking to see this get on, man. This is dope on this side of the camera. So yeah, I'm kind of, I could say, nervous.
You'll be good.
Cameras make me nervous.
The front.
He ain't on the side talking about going like this. Hey man, stop.
Dog. Yeah, wrap it up.
No, but we are here. Like Dre said, we started the barbershop series with the notion of literally being out where the conversations are already happening and providing a platform for these cats to get how they feel and what they're dealing with in life out. And it just blew up. So we had been to a number of shops. And again, this year we're virtual, but we're still having a good time doing it. And we're still having, some strong dialogue. That dialogue is continuing to happen. Is still happening. So Dre, with the pandemic and everything that hit us like it hit us, that we couldn't go into the shops, we couldn't go into the community like we would normally do. What was a major factor for you in the transition of doing everything virtual?
Well, it took a while. We set up the studio and, definitely we were already working with Darryl. That's actually how he kind of came on. We were doing a barbershop series. I think it was like 2019 or so or something. And he had hit us up and he was like one of our past honorees at our Father's Day event. And he had hit us up about, hey, y'all going out and doing this stuff. Let me live stream. And this was before it was even a factor, right? Like now it's like, this is what everybody's doing. So, we set the stuff up, a lot of learning, a lot of YouTube University tapping into, some of our partners, some of our other brothers, like Proofing the Play and Converge Media and tapping into different and Dancing in the Rain Media and just tapping in with folks that got knowledge just to learn about this. And then, really, it really wasn't that difficult to set this up because we already did the groundwork to learn a lot of the stuff. It was more just the coordination of the folks that we wanted to be there. We had to, of course, we ain't meeting if we ain't eating, we had to coordinate some food and all those types of things, and then streaming it out through our platform. So it's definitely not how it normally is. We like to get out there and have conversations and uplift, and if we got a few dollars we pay for folks haircuts and only that, like, you're uplifting black businesses. Those are cornerstones of our community, and some of those are literally the strongholds of businesses that are still within Seattle, as the barbershops, and that's where a lot of conversations are happening and have been happening. That's why we decided to really go, especially with our focus on black men and boys. This is where they're at. You know what I'm saying? They're in the barbershops getting them haircuts. There's already conversations going on there. So why not go in there and facilitate some conversations? So I think this has been a good, interesting opportunity. I think one, especially the conversation we had with Larry and Black Stacks and, yeah, you know, Jeffrey and JP. And that was just, you know, that was a hitter. You know what I mean? We were smashing Adam. So, I mean, all the conversations been great, even with the cast of your play. That's, you know, the play that, yeah, it was dope. You know what I mean? So, yeah.
Well, that's what's up, man. Yeah. I want to give a shout out to my barber, Jay Styles, Jamil Shabazz. You know what I'm saying? I'm coming to see you. You can tell. Don't worry about it. I'll be there. I'm coming to see you. D, you know, you jumped in, man. Like Dre said, you were one of the first ones that jumped on with us with the Barbershop Series, saying, "Yo, man, I just want to be there. Let's film this. Let's get this out there." And man, cats were loving it, bro. What is driving you to keep moving forward with what it is you do?
Man, I tell you, you know, seeing the work on the other end, the gratification of folks that, you know, have seen, you know, production and stuff, and me just taking in my whole purpose and journey and basically talking to myself outside of myself, like, yo, this is your lane. This is where you're supposed to be, right? And it makes so many things make so much sense in my life where, you know, without the gratification and without the thank yous and the appreciation, you know, I would still be kind of lost in some other stuff I'm dealing with and like, why is this happening kind of a deal? Yeah. And right. It makes sense after a certain point, you know? And so you just got to be patient, I think, and it was my own medicine.
Oh, that's
and,
what's up.
And be patient, and the story unfolds, right? And so, yeah, so just being a part of the journey, being a part of amplifying what the founders were doing, you know, when I met you guys, and I'm just like, yo, these guys are like for real, and they actually like each other, right? Like Dre always says, like, yo, you guys, I mean, we're going on walks and Sewer Park together and all this stuff. So I just wanted to be a part of that, and it's just dope to be a part of that journey.
That's what's up, man. I'll say this. You just touched on patience, right? A lot of organizations get started. And again, like you said, we sat down when we first started, man. I mean, we met. And we talked and we discussed, and one of our founding statements was, we are not here to recreate the wheel.
Right.
We are not, right? BUILD does not have the answers to everything. We want to get some access, right? We want to be a resource to answers. And so it took us patience. And so if nothing else, we want to shout out to any organization that's, you know, getting started, you young cats out there, young ladies trying to, you know, get something started. Don't think, you know, it has to happen right now. You got to be patient, right? And, you know, Dre, he's a humble cat. You know what I'm saying? But Dre is, like, literally the backbone to BUILD. He holds it together, you know, because so much is going on in everybody's life with BUILD and all the other organizations that we are a part of and that came out of BUILD. You know, so we're still tight with a lot of the cats that we met. And so this platform is still providing for us an opportunity to connect. Dre always says, you know, we ain't just, you know, drinking the juice. We ain't just, you know, we in it.
Right.
We're doing it. You know, I'm like pouring in sugar and stirring.
He messing my quotes up, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead and tell me how it went.
We ain't just serving the juice, we're drinking the juice.
That's what I said right there. I said we.
That's exactly what you said.
But yeah, man, we love this work. And so, yeah, D, that you said patience, and that it allows you to get in a lane and go, man, this is kind of like where I'm supposed to be, right? Because, I'm at an age right now where I'm, you know, me and Dre talk all the time. I'm balancing. And Dre's favorite line for me is, man, you just need to figure out what you want to do.
What's it worth? Shit.
You just need to figure out what you want to do, right? And it's, you know, it's that's a true statement. But figuring it out when you got so many pots on a stove, right? You got 6 pots on a stove and you ain't got 4 eyes. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And it's kind of difficult to really know. But I'm moving forward and I feel good about it.
Yeah, and it's good to have those options. And it's also hard to transition from things that you're used to doing. You know, I mean, if you've been doing something for a very long time, it's hard to transition. But what I'm learning, you know, talking to cats like AC and Larry and other folks, it's like, you know, what's your happiness worth? You know what I'm saying? Like, how much drag is it, you know, does it put on you? So, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like, those are real conversations that we have. Like, we really rock. That's an example of us really rocking. And you know, folks have bumped heads with each other and worked our way through it. Like, it's no, any relationships has ups and downs. And if it fractures, like, there wasn't enough equity in the relationship, in my opinion, if it's going to fall apart over a bump in the road. Right. And sometimes, you know, we've had situations where that's happened, you know, it's like, it's, you know, and those are all learning lessons, you know, it's like, you know, you try to, everything happens for a reason, you know, try to let those be learning lessons. But like DQ, like you said, like, we really rock. Really, you know, and the work is a byproduct of that. We are the work. Like, us having relationships Absolutely. As black men working together, that's counterintuitive. We've been trained not to do things with each other. So us just hanging out and trying to plan things out, that's dope in itself, period. Let alone all the stuff that we're doing within the community, you know what I'm saying? So sure. It's, and we're bringing on, you know, some other folks, like, you know, DQ and G, you know, they got, you know, gone last year, and, you know, we're like, been rocking with Deontay for a minute, so trying to get him in the mix, you know, in some leadership stuff. So, and it's, you know, like I said, even like, this is opportunity, you know, for Darryl to get on the side of the camera, you know what I'm saying, and build those,
makeup,
juices and berries. You got the juices and berries, you got the waves in the beard, man. So it's, you know, it's this opportunity. And then, you know, there's some of the initiatives that we're doing too, like the Build Black Wealth Initiative. You know, we're able to give out money. You know, we're not, you know, like you said, Isaiah, like, we're not in this to try to make no money. It's not, and if it starts feeling like work, you know, it's like, it ain't worth it. You know, that's really why we started doing this, is because our hands were tied in some of the positions that we had, or I was sidelined dealing with some personal stuff. So I wasn't able to have a job in that arena, but it's like, the job doesn't stop. Your job title doesn't mean what you can and can't do.
Absolutely.
It's really about what you want to do. So, yeah. See what you got to say.
I was getting ready to say edit.
We ain't editing nothing. This is Jay-Z.
No, let's talk about some of our upcoming projects, though. We got some stuff coming up.
Yes.
That we're getting ready to do.
So this year, I can just kind of talk about some of the stuff that we've done this year and what we got planned out for this year. So, you know, we had the Build Black Wealth program, and it's, you know, we're evaluating the data that's come in from the surveys and stuff that we took. So we injected $5,000 into individuals who came to workshops so they could start on their wealth building journey. And we did workshops around taxes, life insurance, estate planning, goal setting, health is wealth, home ownership, and a number of other things. And then we also had our incubator program, which we're really about to ramp up, where we gave 20 black-led businesses and organizations $1,000, which isn't much, but it's really about the cohort of folks coming together to be able to share knowledge. And I'm hoping that, you know, Build and Brick can learn some things from other folks. Everybody's doing things differently. So how can we create a learning environment for us to really work together and develop some partnerships through that process? You know, 2022, we're doing our second Mother's Day event. You know, I don't know if it's like our sixth or seventh Father's Day event. We're going to do our flag football event again, kickball. Darryl plugged us with the partnership with the Ark Lodge. So we're going to have movie nights at the Ark Lodge coming up for free for the community. We got a lot of stuff going on. Guys leading our Build the Vote initiative. We're working with the Office of Labor Standards to do education around labor laws within Seattle. So we got a lot going on. And I'm really excited, too. Like, you know, I've talked to you a few times, Z, and you know, about you and your son Q, and my son, he's up at, you know, coming of age, where, you know, really getting those young men's groups started back up. I've been tapping back in with some of the cats, Caleb and Nabil and all those guys, Jalen, Amir, you know, just a bunch of the cats that I've been in touch with over the years, and really, you know, even some of the older cats that are like 25, 26, 27, and just figuring out how we could start, you know, bringing cats together, even if it's like once a month, break bread and have some conversations. I'm really excited about that with this COVID kind of letting up off us. But, you know, of course we get requests here and there, but that's really, it's a busy year. We got a lot going on. I mean, it was a downtime for 2020, and 2021 picked up, and 2022 picks up, and we're still doing some of our equipment deliveries and rentals and stuff to try to help other organizations, but we're kind of scaling back on that as well. But, you know, I know Acts on Stage got a lot going on and big things happening, and, you know, looking forward to being able to support and any way that we can with that too.
Without a doubt. Yeah, we are loving the partnership that we have with BUILD at Acts on Stage, where we are, you know, utilizing the facility. You know, it is a community space, 10806 12th Avenue Southwest and White Center, directly in the middle of White Center is a black theater. Thought I'd get after y'all real quick like that. You know what I'm saying? We'll pull it sometime. You know what I'm saying?
Drop the beat.
No, we're just loving this, man. And D, you got a lot going on with Dancing in the Rain, man. It's just every time I turn around, you're at this spot, you're at that spot, you know. And so how are things moving with you?
Things are moving good, man. I've had a busy few weeks. I like to keep myself busy. It keeps my mind flowing. It keeps my purpose and everything kind of intact with just keeping my mind flowing. Keeping me sane, really, right? You know, these video cameras really saved my life in a way. So paying homage, I just keep it going. I don't like to sit still, because tell you the truth, I'm a procrastinator, bro. So I like to when nothing's going on at all, I will figure out who I made some kind of commitment to in the conversation a week ago, a month ago, a couple months ago. Okay. And I call somebody up so I'm not sitting around and I can't use my illness as an excuse, because I will. I will chill. And so basically, man, I'll call somebody and be like, you know, Isiah, man, we talked about the little thingy thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's finally put something together, right? And then that way I'm busy.
Right.
And I'm not sitting around. I'm not worrying about, you know, what the doctors are talking about is going to happen or nothing, man. I'm like, oh, I told him I was going to be there on Thursday, and I might let myself down and chill and miss something, but I'm not going to let Isiah down.
That's
right.
What's up, man.
So I've been doing a lot of work though, working with NAM, doing some storybook. We just had the Senator, Tawana Nobles, reading the Green Book.
Okay,
We were out at the Heritage Museum out in Tacoma, working with the University of Washington with CCDE Equity Group.
Okay,
over there. And so, you know, I just pretty much, you know, I'm still working with Converge.
Yes, sir.
I'll get a call from Omari, and he'll say, we got a special assignment. I need you here, need you there. And, of course, it's Big Omari. All respect to the leadership and just the expertise that I got to see over there. And so, when you call, bro, man, I'm just a call away. So, you know, with Convergency, what else am I doing, man?
I like that you said the camera, video camera, saved your life.
Oh yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
They save you, because really I'm thinking did. About me personally. I some stuff on video that almost ruined my life. You understand what I'm saying? I'm just saying. Almost.
You're still standing.
The tape is rolling. Yeah, absolutely. As I entered, my kidney disease battle. I was lost, man. I was like, yo, my life was, you know, I was at Boeing on a management pathway. And then all of a sudden it came to like a screeching halt, and I had to go on dialysis, and then Boeing figured, you know, I was better on the outside than on the inside, collecting everybody. And so, man, I was literally on the couch in the fetal position.
Wow.
For weeks.
Right.
For for weeks, and then my wife got she got tired of walking over me, and she gave a good friend a call. Said, "Man, come get this cat." He came over, shook me up, said, "D, man, we're not gonna do this pity." This pity part. I'm like, "Man, but man, it was Boeing and all this kidney disease and, you know, the whole nine." And so he's like, "Man, look, man, give me a call when you're ready to do something and you're ready to get up." I got up, gave my man a call, said, "Man, I'm ready to do something. I don't know what it is, but I'm going to do something to keep busy." And after having some conversations with the good brother, it became evident that I was going to use the cameras that I had been kind of as a hobby,
yeah,
doing some little stuff around the house, some little home, funny movies and stuff. It became apparent it was going to be the video cameras. And so I was able to pour everything, slowly but surely, everything, my soul, my time, me becoming a new person, because I had to actually leave who I was and become this new cat picking up this camera, leaving Boeing, leaving everything that I thought was the norm, a 9-to-5. Right. I had to leave all that behind. So I had to recreate who DQG was.
That's what's up, man.
And so the camera helped me stay focused in that. Along the way, so many great things were going on for me. I became a member of Natus. Don't ask me to give you the acronyms. but they're actually the organization that pushes and runs the Emmy.
That's what's up.
Yeah, and so I'm just raising my hand a lot there and hey, I'll do that, and you guys need somebody to do it, and I'll go step in, I'll go hang out with somebody and hold the mic or go, yeah, do something and just be an extra. And you know, that's one of the most beautiful things that's happened that I can say the most unexpected thing that came out of that was I ended up being a producer last year of the 58th annual Emmys for them.
Come on, man.
For them boys. So much good stuff is happening to me, man, that I can't even complain. And it's, I just chalk it up to the journey, you know, because let me do it the reverse way. The shows that I've been able to put on, being able to be there for Converge, what we did with the Barbershop Series back then before live streaming was popular, mm-hmm, none of those things would be happening if I was never struck with kidney disease.
Right. True.
Right? So it's a part of the journey. And
I like it, man.
Z, this reminds me of what you always say, you know, like you're either a teacher or a student. It's like he had to learn all this new stuff. So
absolutely.
Can you share a little bit of what you mean when you say that to folks? Like, you know.
Yeah. So as somebody who started working for the Parks Department 31 years ago, working with young people, I was always, you know, older than them. And then, you know, they would always look at you and go, "Ooh, I want to do what you're doing. I want to do how you're doing it. I want to drive what you're driving." And they wanted to do it right now.
Right.
And I kept saying to them, "I'm not your next step. I'm not your next step. Let's find out what your next step is. And let's take those steps accordingly." And so in doing so, a lot of them thought they could get to a certain step and then they made it.
Right.
And I'm like, "Nah, you got to keep stepping." Right. It's like education. It's like being a teacher and a student. And I kind of broke it down to them. And I was like, "Yo, man, in any aspect of life," and people get caught up in titles, they get caught up with how much money they make and, you know, the status
and age and stuff like that.
Age and all of that. And the truth of the matter is, in every aspect of our lives, we're either students or teachers. And I always say students first and teachers, right? Mm-hmm. And that as a student, you got to pay close attention, because we've all can sit in a room and listen to a teacher, but who's really picking up on what's being said?
Right.
Right. And so, you know, as a student, you get that right information. So when it's your turn to teach, and it is your turn to teach, right, different age levels and whatever, you could teach the right thing. And so I just feel like all of that is really important. So that is, man, that is a testimony, bro. that you said you had to recreate, you had to learn, you know, and recreate D. And you said it started off with little funny stories at home, you know, a little happy story. For the record, that's how mine started out too. A little happy story, I thought. I'm just saying, y'all, be careful out there with the little happy stories at home. Anyway.
Yeah. Hilarious.
No, but D, man, I'm glad you joined us, bro. I mean, it took us some talking into. We had to literally talk you into being here with us, man.
Man. This side of the cameras, no joke.
So he was ready to cancel gigs. Like, I could send somebody else. I'm like, nah, man, you ain't need to cancel that, man. Just let's just get this popping.
Yeah,
man. Yeah. No, this is dope being not just on this side of the camera, but just part of the conversation, man. I'm usually monitoring it and through some headphones. And this is dope, man. You know, this is gonna live on, and it's just, man, part of the journey, you know.
Oh, man, I personally want to say that I'm glad that you brothers are a part of my life, because I've definitely gone through some, and I'm gonna continue to go through some things. And I'm just going to need that support, man. When, you know, you got your family and you got, and for my life, you know, I got my church family and I got, you know, friends, but I got BUILD.
All right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's a solid foundation, you know? And so I just want to say thank you, brothers, for real.
Yeah, for sure. And I also think a lot of people really understand, especially like dealing with funders and stuff, they don't really understand, like, that's the foundation of what we do is really rocking. And like, you know, we all ain't going to agree on everything all the time. But, you know, at least we're all like-minded. We're all trying. Or at least we're all in the same book. You know what I'm saying? We may not be on the same page or the same chapter, but at least we're in the same book. So, likewise, I appreciate, you know, the community that I had. You know, like a lot of my podcasts I talked before or just talking to folks. Like, I didn't have no uncles or, you know, my brother died when I was 23. My older brother died when I was 23. And I didn't know my dad. So, it's like, you know, but my son doesn't have those issues.
That's right.
Like, he got a lot of positive folks around him. And that... Same thing with you. Like a tragedy turned into something super amazing. So, like, you know, I'm a strong believer that everything happens for a reason. The other thing I think that's dope that you do is pulling in, like, your fam. Like, you know, I met Nico through you and, you know, like, your son coming in, him, you know, shooting stuff with us at the barbershop thinking he's dope at basketball, but, you know.
No, he don't.
You know, so yeah, shot a shot right in the garbage, right?
That's what's for you, Q.
That's where it goes, right? So, you know, I think just that's the way it's like family too. You know, like we're all, you know, it's all community, all fam, and you know, like I'm excited to see what's coming in the future for us. And like likewise, like Z said, like I appreciate you brothers being in my life, other brothers being in my life. Like it's so beneficial, you know, just to be able to have somebody to talk to when cats are dealing with stress and depression and crazy ass people being disrespectful, and just having somebody listening on that be like, man, you're tripping, you know, like, you know, that's cool too, for somebody to be like, hey man, you know what, you know, they right, you wrong. You know, so just keep it real.
We're not going to allow anybody to slap us.
No,
I beat somebody. Okay. let me stop. Oof.
We've been talking about Z starting this comedy back up. And we're gonna call it. I wish a motherfucker would slap me. Tour. That's what we're gonna call it.
That's for real.
Yeah, nobody getting slapped around here, man.
And like Dre said, we don't always agree on everything, and that's cool. Like tonight, we was like, okay, y'all, we gonna do this thing. What color shirts are we wearing? And I'm dark skinned. I can wear anything. Darryl kind of dark. He ain't wear anything. You see, we got Dre on the end. You see where Dre at, don't you? On the end. You know what I'm saying? That light skinned people can't really wear everything. You know what I'm saying? So we ain't want to put him in the middle and, you know, be just glowing up. He's just been glowing. He'd be like,
okay, we're on the comedy already. Yeah. is it my turn yet?
No, I'm good, man. We're going to end this program tonight. We thank y'all for joining.
Yeah, man. But now, you know, we was talking about just the brotherhood, and let me say my bit, because the Saturday calls, man, is, you know, getting together in the morning when we do, and I haven't been on in a while because I've been so busy.
Yeah.
The last few Saturdays been tied up with the Majestics. Catch me behind the camera on that one. But, you know, man, this last year has been wild, man. You know, not that the year before was it, right? But but specifically though, being able to just tap in, lost moms this year, had COVID and caught a real bad case, man. And before that, there was some other family drama stuff going on. But to be able to tap in and kind of reset, man, that once a week thing is so dope. I mean, I don't have a 9-to-5 that I'm going to, right? This dancing in the rain is what I do.
Right.
So I don't get that, what some people might get, some sort of a balance, Monday, you kind of, there's going to be Timmy and then Rachel. You just kind of go through some little rituals or whatever. Man, I don't have that, right? So, the only thing that's constant, is my 3 days of dialysis. And outside of that, I balance out through craziness and whatever. But the Saturdays, man, those like kind of bring stuff back. We can talk, laugh. And it's just a beautiful thing to be amongst. I mean, we got the age range can go from like 20 to 70 or something like that. And so
I'm not 70.
You're up there, though. You got
seven.
You got a copy of the original Green Book, right?
He got
a copy of that original Green Book.
Oh man! So that's just so dope, man. And it's definitely kept me balanced, for sure, with all the craziness and just needing to tap in.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to us getting up out of here, spending some time with each other, but also like getting back in person, you know what I mean? Like being a black man is stressful enough. And then you throw COVID and Donald Trump presidency and protest and, all this other shit on top of it. It's just, I'm saying, and in life in general, like we got kids, we got relationships, we got jobs, we got all this things that we got to light bills. We got all this stuff that we got to manage, and then you can't even be around each other. I'm a hermit crab, so it ain't, I'm like, I'll be at the house anyways, but, at least I want to be around my brother. So it's like, what were you about to say, Z?
I was going to say, I'm just a blessing that I was never diagnosed, never got COVID. I mean, so I'm like, I've been safe from that. My wife even got it. So though I didn't get COVID, there was a video.
The punchline returns.
What?
The punchline returns.
No, I'm good.
It was crazy.
So the COVID, man, I almost feel like when I got it, I mean, I had it bad. It ended up, it was probably about from the 3rd, I got sick on the 3rd of January. And about a week into it, man, I was in a wheelchair, bro, because I could not move, right? And I had to get up there. And it would have been cool if I didn't have dialysis to go to, because I'd just been laying in bed going, baby. I rub my feet, right? I'd have been doing all that. But no, I had to get up. So it was tough just to walk. But I escaped, bro, so long. I mean, so when COVID hit, it took me this long to catch COVID, right?
You were in the mix too. Like I said, you didn't even talk about like supporting all the protests and all the stuff that was going on in 2020. Not only just Converge, but you were in the mix at all them big, huge events. And
that's the deal.
Yeah.
And
so
I was in the middle. And, and when we started, we were at Cut. Edit? We edit? No edit?
No, you're good. We're Jay-Z.
We're really. No, so when we first started, I remember Omar gave me the call and said, man, I got an idea. I got a show. I'm going to call it the Morning Update Show. What are you doing tomorrow? Right? And I said, man, nothing. Contracts canceled out, for some other stuff I had going on. So I get my bags ready and stuff, and I'm ready to go. And right, Inslee had just shut down the state. So my kids were at home from school. Wife was at home working from home. And they're all like, man, where are you going with the compromised immune system?
Right.
And so I was like, Amari needs me, right? And so, of course, they were just like super like, oh, man, where are you going again? Like, again. And just thought this was going to last for a couple of days. And, you know, thanks to Omari and Treyana, we kept it rolling, right? Yeah. So we kept going. But what's the brother's name? Man, I'm going to mess this one up. Oh, man.
Flickenheimer?
No.
It's on the tape. His name is on the tape.
No, man. No, I'm messing with his name, man. But Omari found
just describe
somebody
him.
To come in
just
and
describe him.
Clean.
You know,
he's from Africa Town, man, okay. The homie.
From Africa Town.
Yeah, he be with my nephew all the time. I don't know why I can't think of his name.
Elijah.
He's my friend in the corner. Yeah.
Okay.
Elijah. So Elijah. Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Okay. We care about you, Ishmael.
No, but the homie are real cool peoples too, man. He has several businesses actually, but one of them was detail cleaning, disinfecting, and the whole nine. And so, you know, and I was telling Amari about the kind of beatings that I'm getting leaving the door. I'm like, man, the family's like on my head, right? Omari talked to Elijah and we worked out a little somewhere. He was coming in, cleaning the studio for us, like overnight, like each night, right?
Oh,
so I was able to tell, you know, the family that and made them feel a little bit more secure. But yeah, that was when it first started. And then, you know, when we moved our studio up to like the chop area, the wife is really like, oh, you're about to go up in there? And then you're like, you're going in the middle of all them people? Yeah, so yeah, I was in the middle of it, so I escaped some stuff. Like you said, the protest, Jimi Hendrix Park, where we was out like all day. For those shows, I was, but I'm.
Yeah, it was
this
on
is marble, huh? But I was, yeah, knocking on. Yeah, no. So I escaped something. So I mean, you know, in the way I roll and with life and journey. It was like, you know, when I got it and I survived it, I was like, okay, it's supposed to be like this. I made it out to the other side. So all that was, but it was my time, I guess. Cause I have been dodging COVID, yo.
The Matrix.
Yeah. I have been dodging it. And I was in the thick of it, like you said, so.
Yeah. Thousands and thousands of people. Cause you was at the, We Wanna Live protest. You was at the Juneteenth, you was at all that stuff.
Paid the fee.
You was at all them joints in the thick of it. But yeah, so it's been amazing to watch from where you started, you know, to stepping out into it and then to really where you're at now. You know what I mean? So I think I think you're getting everything that's due to you and more, you know. So it's been dope. And not only that, like it's been a support. Like those things were so needed to be able to televise those things that were happening. And that's really what you were talking about. And even Proof, I think Proof was innovative with a lot of that, you know, conversations before, like people just, you know, with gentrification, people being pushed out, which was one of our topics, like people being pushed out. You can't come to the grandbaby's basketball game or football game. So we got to live stream this stuff. So I think, you know, people just, and that's what's dope about Black folks. Anyways, we're always so innovative and figure out a way to adapt to the environment that we're in. So yeah, it's dope.
Well, that's what's up, man. So man, I've enjoyed this.
Yeah, it's dope.
This is dope. Yeah,
this man. Yeah.
I'm ready for my own show.
Okay. Come on.
So what we're gonna do now is
we're gonna get those tapes
right after this commercial break, y'all. We're gonna come right back with Dre and Isiah on the Darryl Show on the DQ
Jizzle
on the DQ Jizzle Show.
But yeah, man, we want to thank y'all for joining us once again. Again, I'm your boy Isiah Anderson Jr.
DQ,
Dre.
Until next time, y'all, keep building, man. Peace.
Peace.
God bless.
Peace.